Putnam Berkeley Audio presents About a Boy by Nick Hornby. Read by David Cale.
Have you split up now, then?
Are you being funny?
People quite often thought Marcus was being funny when he wasn't. Couldn't understand it. Asking his mum whether she'd split up with Roger was a perfectly sensible question, he thought. They'd had a big row, and then they'd gone off into the kitchen to talk quietly. And after a little while, they'd come out looking serious, and Roger had come over to him, shaken his hand and wished him luck at his new school. And then he'd gone.
Why would I want to be funny?
Well, what does it look like to you?
So he's gone.
Yes, Marcus, he's gone. He didn't think he'd ever get used to this business. He had quite liked Roger, and the three of them had been out a few times. Now, apparently, he'd never see him again. He didn't mind, but it was weird, if you thought about it. He'd once shared a toilet with Roger, when they were both busting for a pee after a car journey. You'd think that if you'd peed with someone, you ought to keep in touch with them somehow.
What about his pizza?
They just ordered three pizzas when the argument started, and they hadn't yet arrived. We'll share it, if we're hungry.
They're big, though. And didn't he order one with pepperoni on it?
Marcus and his mother were vegetarians. Roger wasn't. We'll throw it away, then, she said.
Or we could pick the pepperoni off. I don't think they give you much of it anyway. It's mostly cheese and tomato.
Marcus, I'm not really thinking about the pizzas right now.
Okay. Sorry. Why did you split up?
Oh, this and that. I don't really know how to explain it. Marcus wasn't surprised that she couldn't explain what had happened. He'd heard more or less the whole argument, and he hadn't understood a word of it. There seemed to be a piece missing somewhere. When Marcus and his mum argued, you could hear the important bits. Too much, too expensive, too late, too young, bad for your teeth, the other channel, homework, fruit. But when his mum and her boyfriends argued, you could listen for hours and still miss the point. The thing, the fruit and homework part of it. It was like they'd been told to argue and just come out with anything they could think of.
Did he have another girlfriend?
I don't think so.
Have you got another boyfriend?
She laughed. Who would that be? The guy who took the pizza orders? No, Marcus, I haven't got another boyfriend. That's not how it works. Not when you're a 37-year-old working mother. There's a time problem. There's an everything problem. Why? Do you mind me having boyfriends?
No, of course not.
You've been really good about everything, considering you've had two different sorts of life. He understood what she meant. The first sort of life had ended 4 years ago, when he was 8, and his mum and dad had split up. That was the normal, boring kind, with school and holidays and homework and weekend visits to grandparents. The second sort was messier, and there were more people and places in it. His mother's boyfriends and his dad's girlfriends, flats and houses, Cambridge and London. You wouldn't believe that so much could change just because a relationship ended, but he wasn't bothered. Sometimes he even thought he preferred the second sort of life to the first sort. More happened, and that had to be a good thing. Apart from Roger, not much had happened in London yet. They'd only been here for a few weeks. They'd moved on the first day of the summer holidays, and so far it had been pretty boring. They'd been to have a look at his school, which was big and horrible, and wandered around their new neighbourhood, which was called Holloway, but really they were sitting around waiting for their London lives to begin. How cool was Will Freeman? This cool. He had slept with a woman he didn't know very well in the last 3 months, 5 points. He had spent more than £300 on a jacket, 5 points. He had spent more than £20 on a haircut, 5 points. How was it possible to spend less than £20 on a haircut in 1993? He owned more than 5 hip-hop albums, 5 points. He had taken ecstasy, 5 points, but in a club and not merely at home as a sociological exercise, 5 bonus points. He intended to vote Labour at the next general election, 5 points. He earned more than £40,000 a year, 5 points. And he didn't have to work very hard for it. 5 points. And he awarded himself an extra 5 points for not having to work at all for it. He had eaten in a restaurant that served polenta and shaved parmesan. 5 points. He had never used a flavoured condom. 5 points. He had sold his Bruce Springsteen albums. 5 points. And he had both grown a goatee. 5 points. And shaved it off again. 5 points. The bad news was that he hadn't ever had sex with someone whose photo had appeared on the style page of a newspaper or magazine. -2. And he did still think, if he was honest, and if Will had anything approaching an ethical belief, it was that lying about yourself in questionnaires was utterly wrong, that owning a fast car was likely to impress women. Even so, that gave him 66. He was, according to the questionnaire, sub-zero. He was dry ice. He was Frosty the Snowman. He would die of hypothermia. Will didn't know how seriously you were supposed to take these questionnaire things, but he couldn't afford to think about it. Being men's magazine cool was as close as he had ever come to an achievement, and moments like this were to be treasured. Sub-zero. You couldn't get much cooler than sub-zero. He closed the magazine and put it onto a pile of similar magazines that he kept in the bathroom. He didn't save them all, because he bought too many for that. But he wouldn't be throwing this one out in a hurry. Will wondered sometimes, not very often, because historical speculation wasn't something he indulged in very often, how people like him would have survived 60 years ago. There couldn't have been anyone like him 60 years ago, because 60 years ago, no adult could have had a father who made his money in quite the same way. So when he thought about people like him, he didn't mean people exactly like him. He just meant people who didn't really do anything all day, and didn't want to do anything much either. 60 years ago, all the things Will relied on to get him through the day simply didn't exist. There was no daytime TV, there were no videos, there were no glossy magazines, and therefore no questionnaires. And though there were probably record shops, the kind of music he listened to hadn't even been invented yet. Right now, he was listening to Nirvana and Snoop Doggy Dogg, and you couldn't have found too much that sounded like them in 1933. Which would have left books. Books. He would have had to get a job almost definitely, because he would have gone round the twist otherwise. Now, though, it was easy. There was almost too much to do. You didn't have to have a life of your own anymore. You could just peek over the fence at other people's lives, as lived in newspapers and EastEnders and films and exquisitely sad jazz or tough rap songs. The 20-year-old Will would have been surprised and perhaps disappointed to learn that he would reach the age of 36 without finding a life for himself. But the 36-year-old Will wasn't particularly unhappy about it. There was less clutter this way. During the night after his first day, Marcus woke up every half hour or so. He could tell from the luminous hands of his dinosaur clock. 10:41, 11:19, 11:55, 12:35, 12:55, 1:31. He couldn't believe he was going to have to go back there the next morning, and the morning after that, and the morning after that. And, well, then it would be the weekend. But more or less every morning for the rest of his life, just about. Every time he woke up, his first thought was that there must be some kind of way past, or round, or even through this horrible feeling. Every time he had ever been upset about anything before, there'd usually turned out to be some kind of answer. One that mostly involved telling his mum what was bothering him. But there wasn't anything he could do this time. She wasn't going to move him to another school. And even if she did, it wouldn't make a whole lot of difference. He'd still be who he was. And that, it seemed to him, was the basic problem. He just wasn't right for schools. And not being right for school was a big problem. Everyone went to school. There was no way around it. The only other kind of person he could think of who didn't go to school was the Macaulay Culkin kind. They'd had something about him on TV once, and they said he got taught in a caravan sort of thing by a private tutor. That would be okay, he supposed. All that night he thought like boomerangs fly. An idea would shoot way off into the distance, all the way to a caravan in Hollywood, and for a moment, when he had gone as far away from school and reality as it was possible to go, he was reasonably happy. Then it would begin the return journey, thump him on the head,
and leave him in exactly the place where he started from. And all the time it got nearer and nearer to the morning. He got to school early, went to the form room, sat down at his desk. He was safe enough there. The kids who had given him a hard time yesterday.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.